We turn now to the race for the White House and a familiar face on the campaign trail. Former Alaska Governor Sarah Palin stumped for Republican candidate Donald Trump today after giving him her official blessing last night in Iowa. In Tulsa, Oklahoma, she took aim for the second day in a row at the Republican establishment.
Here we got a redhead from the Big Red Apple running for president, and yet the GOP machine, all of a sudden, they're saying, we're not red enough. We're not conservative enough. And I say, what in the world do they know about conservatism?
And with less than 2 weeks to go before the first voting begins, we get the latest now from political reporters in two key states. Paul Steinhauser, political director for NH1 News Network, joins us from Manchester, New Hampshire. And O.K. Henderson is news director at Radio Iowa. She is in Des Moines, Iowa. Kay, what is the effect of the Sarah Palin bombshell yesterday in Iowa?
Well, number one, it plays into the Trump playbook. It steals all of the oxygen from the room, and that's all anyone is talking about today is Sarah Palin and Donald Trump. Number two, she's kept in touch with Tea Party activists here in Iowa over the years. And number three, I think it amplifies the core message that he has been spreading. But she uses a phrase typically called crony capitalism, against which she's been railing for years. And he is the embodiment of that in terms of how he's motivating people who are upset against the establishment and the quote-unquote crony capitalists.
There's no question she can suck the air out of the political room. And she's also had the effect of getting people elected, including Ted Cruz to the United States Senate, who seems to have been the one person really campaigning for her endorsement.
And also, she endorsed Terry Branstad here in Iowa when he ran to return as governor in 2010. She was an early endorser of Joni Ernst, the U.S. Senator from Iowa, who won in a surprise in a five-way primary in 2014, right, and then went on to win the seat in the U.S. Senate.
Paul Steinhauser, does it reverberate the same way in New Hampshire?
Maybe not as important here in New Hampshire, but yeah, it's definitely an endorsement that can't hurt Donald Trump. It can only help him here. I was covering Ted Cruz. I was speaking with the senator minutes after the endorsement happened. I was able to talk to him about that, and he definitely downplayed the endorsement. He said he's still friends with Sarah Palin. He recognized that she helped him get elected to the Senate in 2012. But then Ted Cruz looked me straight in the eye, and he said at the end of the day, it's the voters who are going to determine who's the real conservative candidate in this race. And it hurts his argument a little because he's been in a war of words with Donald Trump for 2 weeks now, arguing that Trump is not the real conservative. When Palin comes out and endorses Trump, yeah, it stings a little bit. But at the end of the day, how much do endorsements matter? I guess we'll find out in a few weeks.
Well, of course, it's easy, especially leading up to the voting in just a couple of weeks, Paul, to get caught up in the day-to-day polls. But there are a couple polls in the past 24 mm-hmm. hours which show Donald Trump with a quite definitive lead in New Hampshire.
Yeah, and that has been the case for quite some time. Unlike Iowa, where you've got a real horse race right now between Trump and Cruz, here in the Granite State, Trump has been the front runner, the clear front runner for quite some time. The last two polls that came out in the last 24 hours say the same thing. Right now, the battle is for second place, and we have two polls out in the last two today that are very different. One saying that John Kasich is the clear second place standing right now. Another one shows Ted Cruz in second place. You know, Cruz hasn't been here a lot until this week. He's doing a five-day bus tour. He's getting some pretty large crowds. Kasich is also roaming around the state with his bus, and he's getting some pretty large crowds as well. Don't count out Jeb Bush. Don't count out Chris Christie. Don't count out Marco Rubio. We really have a five-way battle right now for second and third places here in New Hampshire, Gwen.
Is it a five-way battle in Iowa as well, Kay?
It seems to be two tiers of competition here. You have the Trump versus Cruz competing for number one, and then you have Carson and Rubio sort of positioned to be the alternative in that second tier, and then everybody else is in that bottom tier trying to make their way to be a competitor against Carson and Rubio and maybe emerge as the establishment candidate.
Let's talk about the Democratic side of this equation, Paul, which is also tightened up far more than a lot of people expected, especially in New Hampshire.
Yeah, in New Hampshire, it's been a very different story than the rest of the country. We've had this great race between Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders going back to July. That was not the case elsewhere. I know now he's tightened up the race in Iowa, but Sanders has been the front runner in all the polls here, and a new one out just yesterday here indicated him up 27 points. Now, I don't know if we believe that, but he is the front runner here. Maybe it's only by 8 or 10 or 12, but he is the front runner here. And, you know, that has put Hillary Clinton on the defensive. You've seen her step up her attacks against Bernie Sanders over the last 2 weeks. You saw the debate the other night, and just in the last day or two, it's getting even uglier. Listen, Sanders popular here. He's from the neighboring state of Vermont. But I think it also shows that, just like we saw with Republican primary voters in New Hampshire, Democratic primary voters, they're frustrated, they're angry. They're angry at politicians, they're angry at Washington. They look at Bernie Sanders, even though he's a politician, he looks like the anti-politician. That's why he's getting a lot of this excitement, and that's why he's doing well in the polls here.
Are the Clinton folks getting nervous in Iowa, Kay?
Well, she is dedicating a lot of her personal time to come here in Iowa and campaign throughout the weekend. I covered her in Toledo, Iowa earlier this week, and she was telling voters that they need to choose someone who has a sensible, achievable agenda. It struck me that's sort of like your parents telling you that you have to choose the practical. And that's the message that she's going out to Iowans with to counter the Bernie Sanders political revolution rhetoric that's really firing up some of the Democrats in Iowa. This is a real nail biter here in Iowa. It's hard to tell when you're on the ground who has the advantage.
Well, it's funny because people usually resist what their parents tell them about these kinds of things. They love the insurgents, the bad boy. But both in Iowa and New Hampshire, both of you summed this up for me. What are voters telling you that explains what's driving this kind of volatility at this stage in the campaign? Starting with you, Paul.
Well, I think it's just you throw all the rules out the window when it comes to this election cycle. Voters in both parties, they're frustrated. They want something different. They want change. That's why you're seeing Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump here in New Hampshire resonating so well and leading by a lot in these latest polls, Gwen.
Okay.
If I could quote Sarah Palin, last night she said, "We are mad because we've been had." I think that sums up what the grassroots in both parties feels like right now here on the ground in Iowa.
But Kay, you know, one of the cliches of Iowa politics is it doesn't matter until people will show up for these very difficult to manage and organize caucuses. Does that in the end still hold true this year?
Clinton has an advantage in that she started months before Sanders, and she had far more financial resources to plow into an organization that her people think will turn people out on caucus night. Both Sanders and Trump have the problem of actually telling people that they have to go to a specific site at a specific time and figure out the caucus process. It's not like the New Hampshire primary, which is easy. You have to caucus at a specific time and a specific location.
Well, we'll be there with you. Okay, Henderson of Iowa, of Radio Iowa Network, and Paul Steinhauser, of political director of NH1. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
And, of course, we'll always have the latest political news for you here as the PBS NewsHour hosts the next Democratic presidential debate in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, on February 11th.
This will be the first time the Democratic candidates will meet after votes are cast in those Iowa caucuses and just 2 days after the New Hampshire primary.
We're working with Facebook to start discussion among voters now, inviting engaged voters who are still deciding how to vote to join our new Facebook group. You can talk with the PBS NewsHour politics team and possibly have one of your questions asked during the debate.
You can find out more about our debate and our Facebook group on the NewsHour Facebook page.
And we'll see you in Milwaukee on February 11th.